coming up on this edition of Reel to Reel.
I'm Terry Hegarty. I'll tell you why young Catholics in the diocese have decided to choose to serve.
I'm Steve Kiltonic. I'll have the story of a Holyoke Catholic graduate and his journey to become a Franciscan friar.
The Greenfield Catholic community rallies to buy a van for a local family. I'm Carolee McGrath. I'll have the story.
These stories and more are just ahead on this edition of Reel to Reel.
Here is your Reel to Reel host, Sharon Rullier.
Hello and welcome to Reel to Reel as we mark Catholic Communications Weekend. Taking a hint from Pope Francis to serve with love, some members of the Diocese of Springfield's religious education programs got their hands dirty this spring as they helped those in need, while others helped with clean hands, serving food to the needy. Participating in a new program called Choosing to Serve, religious education leaders and their students engaged in a variety of activities this spring that were designed to teach them that service is a vital part of their faith. Terry Hegarty and our staff of videographers made stops all around the diocese to capture some of the youth as they carried out their projects.
High school students across the Diocese of Springfield were choosing to serve as they decided to sacrifice some of their school vacation time recently to help their community. A diocesan youth service project tied to the religious education curriculum called Choosing to Serve, Together We Can Make a Difference, led to the youth and their adult leaders doing a variety of hands-on projects. Students and their teachers used their creative skills to devise unique ways to reach out. The projects were designed to empower youth to experience service as an important part of their faith.
Jesus gave us two commandments, to love God and to love our neighbor. And I think that this is the essence of those two commandments. They're doing their service because of love of God.
Young members of St. Peter and St. Casimir Parish in Westfield held a pancake breakfast for the elderly. The admission price was a donation of toiletry products that were then forwarded to the Holyoke Soldiers Home.
I think it's important to serve those in need because you need to think about everyone, not just the people that have everything. You also need to think about the people that may not have as much as you.
I think it's important to show that you care about your community and that you're making a difference or trying to make a difference. And I think you just need to make sure that you're helping in any way you can all the time.
The week was kicked off at St. Elizabeth Parish in Ludlow with a concert held by youth minister and musician Steve Angrisano.
Repeat after me, here we go.
Children have to experience God, not just be taught the words of Jesus, but to experience them.
I think it's important to follow in the footsteps of Jesus. I think it's really important to do a lot of service acts like that so that you can really express your faith and show who you are as a Christian and Catholic.
In Chicopee at St. Rose de Lima Parish, religious education students took advantage of the beautiful weather and their sports skills to mentor the younger children of the parish.
Service is important to me because I feel like you should give back to the community that you're from or any community because it helps other people that aren't as fortunate as you are. So if you can give back, it's worth it.
I'm really proud of these kids. You know, I spoke with them and said this is a choose to serve. We don't have to do this. And they decided that, yeah, you know, they wanted to do a sports day and they wanted to come out and do something with the kids and be out here and just share their experiences with them.
Youth members of Our Lady of Guadalupe Parish in Holyoke visited the Holyoke Care Center to spend time with the elderly. The arts and crafts, piano playing, and just plain visiting was enjoyed by all.
I think for them to come out today, it's their vacation week, and they're here because they want to be here. And these are the things that they enjoy doing. And I think it's very important for them as well as their families. And I think it's great for the parish community.
Jalen Cruz says it wasn't a sacrifice at all to do this project during school vacation.
I came here with some of my cousins and some of my friends, and I thought it would be a good idea to spend time with each other while spending time with the elderly and having fun with each other and supporting them.
I like to volunteer and help out the community because sometimes you don't have enough money to donate, but you do have time and you can make something and make a difference in the community. And it's part of being a good Christian also.
Bishop Rozanski says that it was inspiring to see the youth putting their faith into action. He says that service is not only for the young members of the church.
For all of us, we realize that we're created by God not merely for self, but that each of us has abilities that we can use to help others. And I think it's important from early on to teach the youth that to make our faith concrete, we really do need to reach out in service to others. We can be of help to others, and we can bring the face of Jesus to them through our service.
Sister Paula says she hopes that the program, while it was centered on school vacation week, will continue to be in place in the diocese for years to come. By participating in these projects, young Catholics here in Franklin County and elsewhere around the diocese have put their faith into action. They weren't obligated to participate, they wanted to take part. Like the title of the program states, they decided to choose to serve. In Turner's Falls at Our Lady of Peace Parish, young parishioners collected more than 100 bags of donated food and then distributed the food to local anti-poverty agencies.
I love doing this kind of stuff. It's community service. It's giving back to the less fortunate than we are. I love not just sitting in the classroom at CCD and everything, but getting to engage in our community and everything else.
You learn, you know, in the textbook to be thankful, you know, and you pray, and part of that is giving thanks to God. And I think by doing something like this, by giving back to your community, you kind of realize what you have to be thankful for.
Carol Holobecki says that she, the kids, and the recipients of this generosity all benefit from projects like these.
It just makes you feel good. It just, your faith in God and knowing that, you know, Jesus wanted everybody to help each other.
Volunteers from St. Anne's Parish in Chicopee helped an elderly parishioner with their outdoor spring cleanup. Youth members of Holy Cross Parish in Springfield also offered their landscaping skills. And teenagers from Our Lady of the Sacred Heart Parish in Springfield helped remove furniture from a closed church. Even though the spring school vacation is over, Sister Paula says the service projects will have a lasting impact.
I think in today's world, religion doesn't have the importance that it had in past. And so I think it behooves us to give young people every opportunity they can, not only to learn about Jesus, to experience Jesus in their lives, to be able to reflect on how they have experienced Jesus in their life.
Efforts to share those experiences involving both students and their religious educators will continue well into the future. Reporting for Real to Real, this is Terry Hegarty.
Well, it's clear that this hands-on approach to service is a very successful way to instill a lifetime of lessons. Terry Hegarty tells us that the diocese plans to continue to use this model for years to come. And speaking of service, one Granby native and Holyoke Catholic alum recently committed his life to service in the Catholic Church as he was ordained a Franciscan priest. Father Joseph Powell was ordained May 2nd in Derry, New Hampshire. He recently sat down with Steve Kiltonic to talk about how, from an early age, he knew he wanted to give his life in service to God.
Over the past two decades, the Powells of Granby have been one of the most recognized families at Holyoke Catholic High School. That's because it's hard to hide when you're one of a dozen, children that is. Debbie and Robin Powell are the proud parents of seven girls and five boys, all of whom attended Holyoke Catholic. The youngest, Gabrielle, will be the last child in the family to graduate from the school in a few weeks. All the Powells share a love for running and cross country. Here's Sam in 2010 crossing the finish line for the Gales. Joe, who graduated in 2006, also kept the tradition alive. Another quality all the Powell children share is the same middle name, Mary, which Debbie says is because of their devotion to the Blessed Mother.
We just love our Catholic faith, the sacraments, and just always participated in all the sacraments, and always had religious books around the house. And so we'd be laying around the house, and Joe would be the one to pick them up.
Joe was the fourth born son and sixth overall. Like his siblings, he loved to explore the woods and fields at the 14-acre Granby homestead. But Debbie and Robin felt there was always something different about Joe, who nearly died at birth when he stopped breathing.
He was in intensive care for quite a while following that, and so he was total gift from the moment he was born.
From the time he was really little, he'd be the one to help out, be the one to step in, do the dishes, or you didn't have to ask him. I did feel like he had a call. I didn't know exactly what that was. It was distinct. There was something distinct about it.
Joe says growing up, he was initially inspired spiritually by his brothers.
I definitely looked up to my older brothers a lot because they were altar servers, Rob, Bill, and Mike. And so I remember being very small and sort of seeing them serve on the altar and thinking, oh man, I want to do that. Like, I want to be up there and holding the cross or serving with the priest.
The Powells attend Immaculate Heart of Mary in Granby and faithfully took their family to Mass every week.
But there were other things that kept the Catholic spirit very alive. Once a month, I remember for the longest time, when I was in grade school, we'd have other families come over once a month for a rosary. We'd pray the rosary, and then afterwards we would feast on whatever snacks they had brought over. That always stuck with me, that faith and your faith life with God is not just about religion, but it's about celebrating life, and it's about living joyfully with others and sharing what you have with others.
It was here at the former St. Hyacinth Seminary, which the Franciscans called home for many years before Holyoke Catholic moved in, that Joe Paul started to seriously think about becoming a priest. And it was the strong presence of the Franciscans here and at his home parish that had a lasting impact on his life. Every weekend, the friars from nearby St. Hyacinth would visit the parish and celebrate Mass.
I always remember that, even as an altar server, being very impressed by them because they just struck me as very joyful guys, very down-to-earth guys, and guys you could just talk to, you could joke with. And they gave wonderful homilies. Once in a while, they come over to visit us here at the house. And they come over in their robes and just have a really great time with us. But no, at the very heart of it, they were spirit-filled men who really gave off just a very gentle joy. And for me, that kind of sunk deep down in the back of my mind.
Father James McCurry has known the Powell family since Debbie and Robin married, which was the same year he arrived at the seminary.
There was always something unique about Joe Powell among his siblings. He used to go on retreats with his father, even as a little boy. He would come and pray before the Blessed Sacrament here in the church. Something kept drawing him to God, to the altar. We Franciscans always thought that he might have a vocation, not just to be a priest, but to be a Franciscan.
Father Adrian Benoit, the former pastor at Immaculate Heart, has known Joe since he was in high school. He remembers Joe running over 3 miles from his house to Mass.
He grew spiritually very, very fast in high school. He would try to make Mass as often as possible, come to confession at least once a month, receive the sacraments, always served, and always was generous with himself towards the church. And so you could see him growing in a spiritual way. I knew right from the beginning that the vocation was in his heart.
Joe said it was a slow process before he realized the importance of having a true relationship with God.
Going from junior high into high school, I started trying to take prayer life more seriously, reading spiritual books, getting good advice from other people who were thinking of religious life or priestly life. For me, it was that whole gradual walk with God that slowly revealed to me, okay, I may not know exactly where I'm going, but God has given me different indications just along the way.
Joe visited the Springfield Diocese and the Marians in Stockbridge. But when he went on a retreat to the Franciscan Order of Friars Minor in Boston, it suddenly clicked.
When I was with the friars and I saw how comfortable I was with them, they really fulfilled that joyful, community-centered vision of life that just always inspired me. I'm like, wow, this is it.
Joe joined the Franciscan OFM order and began 8-year studies to become a friar. He served at parishes in Canada and Boston, studied 5 years in Rome at the Franciscan University before returning home to complete pastoral work at St. Thomas Aquinas Parish in Derry, New Hampshire, we have served for the past 2 years. Joe was ordained a transitional deacon in Connecticut and returned home last fall to say his first Mass with Father Benoit.
Father Joe's simplicity is his greatest quality. He's simple, down to earth, no airs about him, nothing highfalutin, a simple little Franciscan friar filled with joy.
The culmination of Joe's spiritual journey took place May 2nd, when he was ordained a Franciscan friar in Derry. For Joe's parents, the experience was overwhelming.
and to see all his friars, his brothers there. I looked over at them, they were in the pews to our right, and they were just really praying for him. But the beauty of the priesthood, not just Joe.
It was just very, extremely moving, just so, just a blessed event, you know.
I really did just feel amazed and humbled at the overflow of grace that was present at that day. It was just another overwhelming experience of community, and I really felt, oh wow, this is another graced and gifted moment from God that shows you that your vocation is not just you, but it's everyone that is involved.
The next day, Father Joe celebrated his first Mass as a friar at Immaculate Heart of Mary. Returning home to Granby and all the familiar faces gives Father Joe a tremendous sense of gratitude.
They've been so supportive, even when I made the decision and told everyone, okay, I'm going to enter the Franciscan Friars. I just remember that everyone came to me and said, oh, you know, we're so proud of you and so grateful, and we're going to keep you in our prayers. And really just reiterating, you can always come back here, this is your home.
Father Joe has been reassigned back to St. Thomas Aquinas, where he will most likely spend another 2 to 3 years. He calls the New Hampshire parish vibrant and an extraordinary place to be a friar. From there, he could be sent anywhere the friars need him. He's hoping maybe it will be the Holy Land.
You never know where the Spirit blows, so, yeah. But yeah, I never, even in my wildest dreams, never could imagine it would have turned out this way. And you just think, when you give yourself to God, how much He blesses you in ways you never imagined. So it's really awesome.
Wherever the wind takes Father Joe, he's sure to make a spiritual impact on all those whose paths he crosses. For Real to Real, I'm Steve Kiltonic.
And longtime viewers may recall a feature done on the Powell family many years ago when Father Joe was still a little boy. Congratulations to Father and his family. And still to come on Real to Real, a Heath family's prayers for a new vehicle are answered, and a tribute to a beloved former colleague. It's all still to come on this Catholic Communications Weekend edition of Real to Real.
May we our strong protect.
The Chalice of Salvation, your weekly spiritual connection. I'm Passionist Brother Terence Scanlon, your Chalice host, inviting you to take time out of your busy days and join us Sunday morning at 10. This week we welcome Bishop Mitch Wozanski, the Ordinary of our Diocese, as our Mass Presider. The Chalice of Salvation, your spiritual connection, Sunday morning at 10, right here on 22 News.
My name is Karen Blanchard, and I am the Director of Providence Ministry Service Network, located in Holyoke. Every day, Providence Ministries provides a hot meal from our kitchen, as well as emergency food through our pantry services. Your donation to the annual Catholic Appeal allows us to help those in greatest need in our community. Every dollar donated stays here in Western Mass. Please consider giving to the annual Catholic Appeal, and together we can serve with love. To donate, log on to diospringfield.org.
It is a journey that will stay with you a lifetime. Join Father Gary Daly, Father Matthew Auchenbright, and me, Peggy Weber, for a special pilgrimage to Ireland from August 7th to the 18th. Every day will include Mass and adventure. The trip is sponsored by Catholic Communications and organized through John Paul Pilgrimages and Tours. This special trip to the Emerald Isle will include a ride on a jaunting cart through Killarney National Park, a visit to the Aran Islands, the Cliffs of Moher, and the Connemara region. Pilgrims will attend a private Mass at Kylemore Abbey, home of Ireland's Benedictine nuns. The group also will journey to the Marian Shrine at Knock for a private Mass and prayer. They will travel to the northernmost point of Ireland, Malinhead, and then journey into Northern Ireland to see the walled city of Derry and the Giant's Causeway. A tour of the Bushmills Distillery is included in the day. Also on the itinerary is a trip to Armagh and the Boyne Valley. And pilgrims will see the ecclesiastical settlement of St. Kevin's in Wicklow, and then tour Dublin. The tour is filling up quickly, so call now. The land of a thousand welcomes awaits you.
As I mentioned throughout the show today, this is Catholic Communications Weekend, when we celebrate the important work done here in Western Massachusetts and across the country in sharing the good news. And you can help continue this work by your generous response to this weekend's special collection in parishes throughout the diocese. Finally, our last story speaks volumes about the good that can come out of a community bonding together to help someone in need. The Charlton family of Heath, single dad Stephen and his four children, two of whom have disabilities, were in desperate need of a new wheelchair accessible vehicle. Well, as Carolee McGrath reports, thanks to the Catholic community in Greenfield, this family's prayers have been answered.
Okay, guys, let's go to church. Get your coats on. Let's go.
Stephen Charlton rounds up the troops to get to the 4 o'clock Mass on time. It's a bit of a drive from Heath, Massachusetts, down to Blessed Sacrament Parish in Greenfield, but the Charltons never miss.
I love God. I've always loved God. I love Our Lady since I was a little kid. And it's important to, you know, even with my own disability, I have to show an example.
And he does every day. Steve has limited mobility on the left side of his body. He was hit by a car as a child. Steve survived, but tragically lost his three-year-old brother in the accident. As you can imagine, the single father of four has a lot on his plate. His two oldest children have disabilities. Stevie, 18, has autism. Teresa, who is 16, has Sturge-Weber syndrome, a rare neurological and skin disorder which causes port wine stains on the face, seizures, cognitive and physical disabilities.
You can see down the one side of her face is all pink. She had to have a surgery. She would have ongoing seizures, and the option had to be to take out half the brain to, you know, stop the seizure activity.
There's not a lot of rest for Steve, who starts his day at 4:45 in the morning.
The daily routine is she doesn't walk, she doesn't talk, and she's G-tube fed. So we have what's called a feeding tube that she has to have. She has a G-tube, and it takes a 45-minute feeding with that. We have a ceiling lift for putting her in and out of bed, a ceiling lift for bathing her, as well as we do floor exercises with her. We have her in a stander just to get the proper weight on her joints and all.
And yet, Stephen's faith in Christ is almost unbelievable.
You know, you follow the road to Jesus, and that's picking up your cross and following him, and that's what I have to do.
But doing what he has to do became more difficult in recent years because he didn't have a reliable car that was handicap accessible. Getting Teresa in and out of the car was a burden. That's when the Catholic community of Greenfield stepped in, raising money to buy a 2010 Dodge Grand Caravan.
Before getting this van, Stephen drove a small old station wagon. It was extremely difficult to get Teresa in and out of the car, not to mention fitting his three other children and her wheelchair.
What does this mean to you?
Well, you know, 85 pounds is a lot of weight lifting up and down, and having my own disability since I was a child, I was aching in a lot of pain. Now it's like, I have me and my kids now, the van, you push a button and the door opens up, the ramp comes out, and we're like a pit crew getting her in there and latching her in, and it's easy for us now.
Parishioners at both Blessed Sacrament and Holy Trinity parishes in Greenfield raised more than $20,000 to buy the van.
I'm speechless. You guys are wonderful.
That amount, added to the $12,000 raised on a GoFundMe account, was enough to purchase the van. Mary Beth O'Day helped in the fundraising.
Teresa means everything to me. I was actually had the pleasure of being at Teresa's birth when she was born. And Teresa's an inspiration for all of us.
Steve's youngest daughter, 13-year-old Maggie, is a huge help.
I really like the car because it looks kind of like a limo inside. I play with her a lot. I've taught her how to laugh. She gives great hugs. Whenever I hug her, it makes me feel happy. And she's the world to me. I love her so much.
Deacon John Leary from Blessed Sacrament Parish says the response from people was overwhelming.
Literally, I got up at the end of one Mass
at Blessed Sacrament, and I asked them for help. They knew the Charlton family because they're members of the church. And from that personal appeal, we raised $20,000 in 3 weeks.
The Knights of Columbus Council 133 were also instrumental in raising money. They hosted a dinner last fall. The Knights of Columbus had also previously helped out Stephen by buying a lift for Teresa for his house.
This is what Jesus asks us to do, to help people, and this is what we do. It's our number one goal. Everything we do is for the people in the community.
Deacon John, who is involved in the pro-life ministry in Greenfield, says Stephen is an incredible and humble witness for life, although Steve says he's just trying to do his best to follow the Lord.
A lot of people, they don't go to church. They might, you know, be disabled and might not go to church because of their disability or other reasons. But I think it's not always easy what I do, but it's important to show, you know, to myself and to my kids that it's receiving our Lord. That's the biggest thing.
And so he says he gladly picks up his cross, knowing that our Lord is by his side. Reporting for Real to Real, I'm Carolee McGrath.
An inspiring story for sure. And for this week, that's Real to Real. Stay informed throughout the week on all of the latest news and the happenings in Western Massachusetts and beyond at our website, iobserve.org. There you will get the news on the Catholic Church locally and from across the globe. That's iobserve.org. And you can also friend us on Facebook. We are at Catholic Communications. And just a reminder to join Bishop Rozanski as he ordains Deacon Ryan Sliva to the priesthood next Saturday, June 6th at 11 a.m. at St. Michael's Cathedral. Join us in person, or we will have live streaming coverage on iobserve.org. And a special programming note, our show next week on June 6th has been preempted by NBC. We will see you right back here in 2 weeks. We leave you now with a tribute to our colleague Mike Tillotson, who passed away unexpectedly over a week ago. As we mark Catholic Communications Weekend, we remember Mike, who represents the many who work behind the scenes to bring you these shows.
We'll meet again, don't know where, don't know when, but I know we'll meet again some sunny day. Keep smiling through, just like you always do, till the blue skies drive the dark clouds far away. And will you please say hello to the folks that I know? Tell them that I won't be long, and they'll be happy to know that as you saw me go, I was singing this song. We'll meet again, don't know where, don't know when, but I know we'll meet again some sunny day.
We'll meet again, don't know where, don't know when, but I know we'll meet again some sunny day.